The great Australian dream of owning your own home on a quarter-acre block seems to be increasingly out of reach. But what's the solution? Well, one answer is potentially growing up, not out. But that can influence the way we interact with urban spaces and potentially even affects our quality of life. And as Australia prepares for population growth, where to from here? What does Australia look like in a few decades' time?
I think we will grow a lot quicker. I don't think we really grew fast enough, in my opinion, I think, because we're a strange place. Huge continent, very rich, and very few people. We will always attract others. I don't talk about living. Of course, they want to leave you. Our system is good. That's why they come here, too. I saw the Chinese developers here. And believe me, I don't think that they could teach us much. But their system at home is good. That's why they could grow so big. What stops us is our system is very difficult. I'm talking about building, but I'm sure there's in other things. That will change. I think that the political system will change.
It is really quite extraordinary to think that from a building perspective there was a blank canvas and how much we've actually developed. And it's a reflection of that population growth that we have throughout the history of Australia is that issue around we've got to accommodate people. And when you need to accommodate people, you need structures of all sorts of sizes and persuasions. But it is really quite incredible to think of how much land we still have available and what opportunities there are going to be for the future.
So explain our cities. I mean, already they're going up and population density is growing.
Yeah.
I mean, can our cities cope with more people even than what they've got in them today?
They have to cope with more people because if you keep on building cottages, you go too far. Now, what will happen is that smaller places will grow, like Gosford would grow. Service Paradise is growing very well. So there will be more places growing, for sure. We can't just have Sydney and Melbourne and Brisbane. That's for sure gone.
What we've seen in the last 12 months in particular is that interest in living in regional Australia. The numbers of building approvals in some of those bigger regional towns at the moment is quite extraordinary. And I think we're going to see what has been pursued for a long time is that growth of the regions, the opportunities that the regions provide to enable greater population growth, greater and different opportunities for people as they spread out through the country.
But when it comes to property, Australia has a history of boom and bust cycles. The boom cycles have created enormous wealth, but the busts, rare though they might be, have shaken the wealth of Australians and even our banks to their very core. As a property investor, you have to be vigilant about lenders when things start to go bad.
I only stuck to one bank, ANZ Bank. That's all I ever had.
Why ANZ Bank? Tell me, all the way back down at the very beginning, you mentioned the ANZ
first
Bank.
The first guy gave me the money, so I stayed with them.
It's amazing. And still today?
Still today, yeah.
But to a certain extent, as you mentioned earlier on, you kind of are the bank now these days. Yeah. Yes, they're behind the scenes if you want to build a big building, but kind of you're the bank. You're banking for some of the people who are buying apartments.
Yeah, of course. But I used to borrow from them before and give to them.
Yes.
But now I don't borrow, I have my own. But the system's the same here. Nobody should not buy because he can't find money.
So do you think a young person today who finds a block of land in Roseville, say, could do the things that you have done to achieve the things that you've done in their lifetime by starting with just one block of land?
There are many more opportunities today than there used to be in my time. In my time, if you looked at the BRW, the big people were all in property. Today, they're everything. So we couldn't do it in those days. So they have a lot more opportunity, but they are not prepared like I was. Like in my time, wanted to strive to achieve. That's why we came here. That's why migrants should be brought here. They are good because they come here for a purpose. They don't come here to get the dough. So we should bring them, and they're young. So it's a big thing. And we're very good at absorbing them, which is marvelous. At that, I think, and we never talk about it, but we are brilliant at absorbing migrants. Even when I was a kid and I came to school, they, you know, embraced me. I was big mates with all of them. And I was no sportsman. I mean, if I was a sportsman, it would be easy. I was no sportsman. Very nice.
So this is a part of it, isn't it? Embracing people who are coming here to Australia for the first time.
That's it. If we can do it, it's good.
We very romantically think back to the Italian migrants, the Greek migrants to Melbourne, who were really dominant in the residential construction industry, and they saw it not only as a way of creating great businesses, but also creating certainty and prosperity for themselves and their families. You look at the Sydney market, you know, heavily dominated in periods by the Lebanese community, which again saw the construction industry as a really wonderful way of being able to fully participate in the Australian economy. So it's been an industry that has, for a whole host of reasons, really opened its arms up to migrants.
Harry Triguboff, they've all kind of bought something from the international perspective. They've bought risk-taking, they've bought hardship in their own lives and sort of turned that around. I think the really crucial thing is that they can see something that nobody else can see. They can see a market, you know, the kind of modern apartment building. People like Harry could see that the world was going to be different. We were going to have Asian students, we were going to have smaller families, we were going to have people who wanted to be close to where they worked. Suddenly they start developing products that really cater to that, and then they innovate. That's the entrepreneur, seeing something from the consumer's lens that I think it differentiates them from almost anyone else.
So, Harry, yeah, I mean, just tell me, how many apartments have you built around Sydney's eye?
Between 70 and 80, because in the beginning I didn't keep proper records.
Hang on, 70 and 80,000?
1,000, yeah, sorry.
So thinking about that, if there's three people in those apartments, that's like a quarter of a million people, 1% of Australia's population, that you found a house for. Which is pretty incredible, isn't it? That's 1% of Australia's population you found a house for.
And think of it, they come and go.
Yeah.
So many of them stayed there for a while, went.
So tell me this, over the years, what do you think about your own buildings, the standards, the way in which these buildings have been put together?
Yeah. Well, I always tried my best for every building. They ask me which building you like the best, I say they're all the same. Because I did my best every time.
So I can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 Meriton buildings I know you've built. But in Sydney, say, how many have you built in total?
Sydney, say, 20.
20?
Oh, easy, yeah.
So one thing I've never asked you, Harry, I mean, the term high-rise Harry, do you like that or not?
Yeah, very good.
Why?
Well, it took me a long time to build the tall buildings. I was very cautious. But then when I started, I could never stop. I went up and up and up.
You know, Harry Triguboff and Meriton is a phenomenal Australian success story, and Harry is a great Australian, and what he's been able to achieve is phenomenal. High-density apartment living with great amenity, with great open spaces, shared open spaces on transport corridors. What Harry and Meriton have been able to do is package those products up that really appeal to Australians. And when we talk about the industry and the job creation, the wealth creation, the taxation receipts for government, predominantly at a state level, but all levels of government, those sorts of projects, if they don't go ahead, it hurts everybody. So getting that supply into the market delivers all those benefits and, of course, provides a product that clearly people want because people are voting with their feet and for many years have been buying Harry's product very enthusiastically.
You're now 88. And explain the passion you've still got for doing this, because a lot of people would have said, look, Harry, when you first made your first $1 billion, just why wouldn't you stop? But you have never stopped. You turn up for work every single day. You're involved in all these projects. What is it that drives you?
Well, I just like my work. It's not only making money. I only make money so I can make more of it. Because I don't spend much, not much. never did. When I was already only 35, I already made a bit of money. And I remember they were asking me, why do you still work? I said, I like it. When I was 50, again, Harry was, when I was 80, they said, Harry, you're clever that you work. We wish we would work. So there you are. You have to adjust to what you do. And many people ask me, they feel a little bit not completely what they used to be. They say, we can't do this, we can't do that. As long as you find something in your profession where you're still very good, you keep it. But as you grow older, there's less things you can do. And the young guys, they learn the new things which you can't learn. So just adjust.